Good afternoon. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is consideration of Business Motion 3443 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out revisions to today's business. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, President Nelson. Just as well as here. Moved.
Thank you, Minister. Excuse me, no member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 3443 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is portfolio questions. And at question number one, I call Mark Ruskell.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is ensuring that the COVID-19 certification scheme records the vaccination status of people who received their vaccine at With Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
So there is an established process for individuals who have received their coronavirus vaccinations outside of Scotland to upload official proof of their vaccination from an approved country to their Scottish vaccination record through NHS Inform. This will allow those who have been vaccinated within the United Kingdom or internationally to receive a combined fully vaccinated status. We are currently working to increase the number of countries that this applies to.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? I'm wondering, though, if he's aware of an issue where people who've received first and second doses of their vaccines have been unable to update their Scottish vaccination record to reflect this. They have been advised by vaccination helplines that their record could be updated by their GP, but were then subsequently told their GPs only receive vaccination records but cannot update them. Their boosters, which they received in Scotland, are now showing as their first dose on the vaccination app. So it does seem to be a bit of a guddle, Cabinet Secretary, and I'm wondering if you could look into this matter and ensure that any solutions to these kind of glitches in the way that vaccination statuses are recorded and updated can be resolved and then communicated clearly to the public. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as I've indicated before, I answered a question from Mr Rennie and one from Ms Boyack in the last portfolio questions on fairly similar territory of difficulties of updating vaccination status. And I invited both Mr Rennie and Ms Boyack to advise me of the details, and we're working on those particular issues. If Mr Ruskell would like to do so as well, I'll happily try to address those issues. In a programme of this scale, there will undoubtedly be individual cases. The vaccine certification process has worked very well for the overwhelming majority and for a huge number of cases, but I accept there may well be individual cases. But if Mr Ruskell would like to give me more details, I'll happily pursue those issues.
Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. From Monday, the COVID certification scheme ceased to be a legal requirement, but the app does remain available to support businesses wishing to implement a voluntary scheme. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that while it is right to lessen restrictions as we cautiously move forward, such voluntary certification schemes are a valuable tool in maintaining our vigilance to COVID?
Cabinet Secretary.
President, so there is a need for us to remain constantly vigilant in relation to COVID. Although we are in a much stronger position today than we were, there are obviously dangers and risks out there for us in the prevalence of the virus. So the strategic framework that the First Minister set out last Tuesday sets out the type of baseline measures we will have to have in place on an ongoing basis to maintain that vigilance. There will also be testing infrastructure required. But a helpful suggestion that Siobhan Brown makes is that businesses may decide to voluntarily use the certification scheme, and if they wish to do so, the strategic framework encourages them to take that decision.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week, the Information Commissioner's Office said it had warned the Scottish Government and NHS last year that there were serious privacy problems with the COVID status app, but not all these problems were fixed before it was launched. The ICO's Deputy Commissioner said on Friday, when governments brought in COVID status schemes across the UK last year, it was vital that they were upfront with people about how their information was being used. The Scottish Government and NHS Scotland have failed to do this with the NHS Scotland status app. We require both bodies to act now to give people clear information about what is happening with their data If they don't, we will consider further regulatory action. Can the Cabinet Secretary give us assurance that they are acting as requested by the ICO?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I gave that assurance on the Government's behalf at the end of last week, and I think it's important to have this in its proper context. The ICO has asked the Government to redraft the privacy notice to present the information in a concise, transparent, intelligible and easily accessible form. Now, that's, I think that's an entirely reasonable request. There is, of course, and Mr Lumsden will be familiar with this, enormous complexity around the issues in relation to GDPR legislation. So it is important that that is set out clearly and simply. The Government will do so. We welcome the engagement with the Information Commissioner's Office, but I think there has to be an acknowledgement that there is a huge amount of complexity involved in wrestling with many of these questions, and the Government tries to present that information as clearly and as transparently as we possibly can do.
Willie Rennie.
I want to thank the Deputy First Minister for helping out with my constituent's case last month, because the issue was resolved, despite repeated attempts from the constituent to resolve it. There seems to be a particular problem, though, with communication between Scotland and Wales that doesn't exist between Scotland and England on this issue. Has he got to the bottom of what that problem is, and do you think he's going to be able to resolve it?
Cabinet Secretary.
I breathed a sigh of relief that Mr Rennie was able to see that the issue had been resolved. I feared we were having a rematch of the last portfolio question times. So I'm glad that that's been resolved, and I'm grateful to Mr Rennie for his engagement on that question. There are particular issues. There are some more straightforward information sharing agreements in place with England compared to Wales. We're trying to resolve those issues. There's no difficulty in working our way through them. It's just taking time. But I assure Mr Rennie that there are specific issues in relation to those agreements which we need to resolve, and we're working to try to do that.
Question number two, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how its COVID recovery strategy is aiming to support the most vulnerable in Scotland's communities.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the COVID recovery strategy is focused on bringing about a fairer future, particularly for those most affected during the pandemic. Our actions will increase financial security for low-income households, enhance the well-being of children and young people, and create good green jobs and fair work. We are working closely with our partners to deliver that strategy, and alongside the President of the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, I chair the COVID Recovery Strategy Programme Board. This group will oversee the ambitious transformation of public services, and further details on this question are available on the Government's website.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that helpful answer. The pandemic has exacerbated long-standing inequalities and brought hardships experienced by many into the forefront of the public consciousness. And as we all know, demand for support from organisations such as CFINE, a community food initiative in the North East, which offers assistance to disadvantaged, vulnerable and low family incomes, has drastically increased during the pandemic. The pandemic's also shown what it's possible to do when we work collectively to achieve shared goals. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my view that we should all resolve ourselves applying the same energy to tackling hunger, poverty and inequality as we have to tackling COVID-19?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it was very clear to anyone looking at the experience of the pandemic that the inequalities that existed prior to COVID were exacerbated during COVID. And the Government is determined to address that factor, which is why the tackling of inequality, the addressing of hunger, the work to eliminate child poverty lies at the very heart of the Government's COVID recovery strategy. So I very much agree with the point advanced by Audrey Nicholl, and assure her of the Government's determination that we will use the aftermath of COVID and the implementation of the COVID recovery strategy to ensure that we make the maximum impact on tackling inequality and eliminating poverty within our society.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that our children and young people are a group who have been particularly impacted by the pandemic. Given the communication needs of children and young people have been exacerbated by COVID-19, can the Cabinet Secretary advise how the Scottish Government plans to incorporate the recommendations of the Equity for All Children's Speech and Language Therapy Services in Scotland report into its wider COVID recovery strategy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm very sympathetic to these issues because one of the fundamental points that was clear to me during all of my interaction as Education Secretary was that communications difficulties for young people lay at the heart of so many of the challenges and issues that young people who were perhaps isolated within our society or who were not able to fulfil their potential as much as they should have been able to came down to communication difficulties. And the early addressing of those communication difficulties is utterly fundamental to the life chances of those individuals. So I'm wholly supportive of the point that Carol Mochan puts forward. As I indicated in my answer to Audrey Nicholl, the COVID recovery strategy is designed to tackle fundamental inequalities, and that inequality of access to services to overcome difficulties is one of those which we are determined to make sure is anchored at the heart of our strategy.
Question number three, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it's made of any potential impact on Scotland's COVID recovery strategy due to the UK Government's decision to end the legal requirement to self-isolate for people who have tested positive for COVID-19.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, in Scotland, self-isolation has always been set out in guidance for the general population. It is for the United Kingdom Government to decide how to tackle COVID in England. However, currently the Scottish Government will continue to ask those who test positive for COVID-19 to isolate for the recommended period and will continue to make self-isolation support payments available to those who are eligible whilst isolation remains in population-wide guidance. We will publish a detailed transition plan for Test and Protect in March, setting out our priorities in more detail. As with all COVID interventions, all decisions, including those on the future of Test and Protect, will be informed by the latest scientific and clinical advice, as well as careful consideration of the four harms.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. The Scottish Government has rightly plotted its own distinct course in navigating through this pandemic. But does the Cabinet Secretary share my concern that the end of self-isolation in England from 1 April could undermine the hard work and sacrifices that we've all put in to get us where we are now?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, as I indicated in my other answer, it is up to the United Kingdom Government to decide self-isolation policy in England. I think the point I'd make to, in response to Mr Beattie's question is that we all have to proceed with a great deal of care. We don't want, obviously the point of self-isolation is to try to break the circulation links of the virus. And if we don't do that, if we don't do that effectively where the virus is still a very significant presence in our society, then we run the risk of cases increasing and the burdens on our National Health Service increasing as a consequence. So the Scottish Government intends to proceed listening to clinical advice, listening to the epidemiological information and taking actions which we believe to be appropriate for Scotland, and the application of guidance to continue self-isolation and the support arrangements is in our view appropriate at this time.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mr Beattie's question highlights again the fact that there was never any legal requirement in Scotland for people to self-isolate, except in the limited case of international travellers. Yet, nevertheless, people adhered to the rules by exercising personal responsibility. Doesn't this give us a model for the way forward, where we should be relying upon people's personal responsibility, given they've demonstrated they will adhere to public health guidance, and we don't need to make these draconian emergency powers permanent, as the Cabinet Secretary proposes?
Cabinet Secretary.
I fear we're going to be going around the houses at this particular point on a regular basis for the foreseeable future, because it comes down to this issue comes down to fundamentally whether our statute book is equipped to deal with all eventualities that come our way. That's the point. That's why we're doing this. And on any other day, the Conservatives could be criticising the government for not taking enough steps to prepare for scenarios that may come our way. I've heard the Conservatives doing that on countless occasions in the past in my service in this Parliament. So we're simply preparing the statute book for difficulties that may come our way. I hope they don't, because we've we want to avoid these difficulties. But if they do, I want us to be prepared and ready for it. And I don't think that's an unreasonable thing for even the Conservatives in our most grudging afternoon to come to terms with.
Question number four, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what cross-government strategies have been identified as part of its work on COVID-19 recovery to support any communities and businesses in the Highlands and Islands that have not received any or substantial help throughout the pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, the Scottish Government is committed to supporting a fair recovery from the pandemic, including for businesses and communities in the Highlands and Islands. Since the start of the pandemic, businesses in Scotland have benefited from £4.5 billion in support from the Scottish Government, and we've engaged extensively with businesses to ensure our support is effective. Last week, we announced a new £80 million COVID Economic Recovery Fund that will target support for businesses and communities as we move into a new phase in the pandemic. Subject to parliamentary approval, councils in the Highlands and Islands will receive more than £8 million from this fund, and they will have flexibility in how to best use funding to support local businesses and low-income households.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you for that response, and I welcome that flexibility. But the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the funding that was made available during the first lockdown left many businesses behind. And despite the time that elapsed, it was the same funding that was issued subsequently. And that's extremely frustrating for those businesses that received no funding at either on either occasion. And some of those are very close to going under. So can he look at ways that he can help the businesses that have missed out from substantial funding over the piece, enable them to start up again and to survive and go forward to help the economy recover in the Highlands and Islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very happy to engage on that question. And if Rhoda Grant wished to supply me with further examples or areas where she believes that to be appropriate, I would happily consider those. The Government designed a whole host of different business support schemes, some of which applied to a particular sector, such as hospitality. And we tried to design those with as broad reach as we possibly could do, but I accept that there would be some businesses that would not be neatly caught by any of those schemes, which is why we put in place discretionary relief funds for local authorities to do exactly as we're envisaging with the £80 million fund that was announced a week past Monday by the First Minister, which is designed to give local authorities the ability to address, frankly, the issue that Ms Grant puts to me, that there may be businesses that have not been reached by discrete funds that could be supported by more general provision. So I would very happy to receive some further information and thoughts from Rhoda Grant on that question, but I would encourage her to also point businesses in the directions of local authorities who have been given substantial discretionary relief funds to try to address exactly the circumstances that Rhoda Grant puts to me.
Before we move on to question five, can I just ask colleagues to ensure that questions and responses are succinct? Question number five, Christine Graham.
Always seems to happen just before I get up. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Duly noted. To ask the Scottish Government what resource impact COVID-19 has had on the timetabling and delivery of legislation and other proposals set out in its programme for government.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And it used to happen to me when the member used to be in that chair as well. To answer Ms Graham's question is the programme for government published in September 2021 sets out the government's priority of leading Scotland safely through the pandemic. All programme for government commitments, including delivery of legislative programme, are monitored. This ensures any delivery risks are highlighted early and mitigations put in place.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Minister for his answer. The enduring pandemic has certainly caused the government to rightly divert attention and resources from these plans to keep people safe and protect the NHS. But can the minister share whether funds had to be diverted from other budgets to support the efforts to combat COVID-19? And if this is the case, what is the ballpark figure, if he can share it with us? And does he share my view that opposition parties should take cognizance of the scale of the effort and the cost involved in getting us to this stage of the pandemic when asking questions about delays to policies or indeed asking for additional funding?
Minister.
As always, I agree with much of what Ms Graham said. Our spring budget revision last month confirms that our total COVID-19 allocations since the pandemic began exceed the UK government COVID funding received by around £300 million. With this additional amount made up from our central reserves and reprioritisation.
Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In discussing issues that have not had the prominence because of COVID and other matters, the Business Minister will know that Scottish Conservatives have asked on a weekly basis for a statement about maternity services in Moray. I've also tried to get urgent questions. This was in the SNP's manifesto to restore a full consultant-led maternity service in Moray. Can we have a statement or for the Scottish Government to lead a debate on their response to the independent inquiry and report into maternity services? Because we've now had a case of a Moray mum, Alexandra Naylor, giving birth in a lay-by. So can we get time in this chamber to debate this crucial issue so no more Moray mums have to give birth in lay-bys or have to have the fear of giving birth in a lay-by?
Minister.
As always, I'll say to the member that there is a process within place that we work within the Parliament, and your business manager comes to Bureau every week and we negotiate and we come to a decision of what's been put forward. Only this week on that very issue, we said we would look at that issue, and I will contact his business manager in the normal manner.
Thank you. Question number 6, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what additional support and resources it will provide for actions across government to recover from COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Scottish Government recognises the unequal impact the pandemic has had on our communities, businesses and public services, and we are providing significant investment to support recovery, such as the £80 million COVID Economic Recovery Fund that was announced just last week, and of course the investment in the NHS Recovery Plan of more than £1 billion.
Finlay Carson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. Can I take this opportunity to highlight a serious problem that has been encountered by businesses, including a number of gyms who have missed out on vital funding? Dumfries and Galloway Council advised businesses that if they had been in receipt of the strategic funding, they would be contacted, and that happened in mid-January. But as an example, the deadline for leisure businesses was the 31st of January, literally only a 10-day period. The Council, to date, have £1 million unallocated left in the funding pot, admit the turnaround was tight and have been informed by the Scottish Government they will not allow any leeway on the deadline date. Surely if these businesses who received strategic funding money and the Council were aware of them, they should still be entitled to the money they so desperately need. Would the Cabinet Secretary look into this and intervene to ensure that the businesses get the funding that was allocated to them? It is, after all, not the Council's money or indeed the Scottish Government money, but money that's been promised to these businesses.
Cabinet Secretary.
If Mr Carson would like to send me further details on that example, I will certainly look into it. He will appreciate that there are financial rules that have to be followed, that there has to be appropriate scrutiny of grant allocations. So with all of those caveats, very happy to look at that issue. I know there are a number of local authorities who are sitting on unspent allocations of resources for COVID purposes, and I would obviously encourage them, providing these are prudential decisions to take, to make sure the financial support is available to fund recovery in the way that Mr Carson puts to me.
Question number 7, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to local authorities to ensure that disabled and partially sighted people are able to participate in the 2022 local government elections.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank Miles Briggs for the question. Stuart McMillan asked a similar question last month, and I would refer the member to my answer on this topic in Parliament on the 2nd of February 2022, PQ reference S60/S60-00696. Returning officers have a statutory responsibility for running local government elections. Under the law, they have to make certain provisions for voters with disabilities and sight loss, including tactile voting devices, but much wider support is typically offered. I'm committed to working in partnership with the community to take forward improvements on accessibility.
Miles Briggs.
Can Can I also ask the Minister whether or not local authorities will be asked to publicise the order candidates will appear on the ballot paper ahead of the elections, as this is often a key piece of information which blind and partially sighted people are looking for and hasn't been previously provided. And given that the Northern Ireland Assembly are providing voter kits, including audio devices at the elections to blind and partially sighted members of our community, can I ask what plans the Scottish Government have to review this and actually look towards trialling voter kits here in Scotland?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Basically, on your first question, the idea was I've been working with, I went to a recent visit with the CPG on visual impairment, and this issue was brought up, and it's an ongoing issue, and it's one that we're willing to look at and try and look for to find solutions to help many of the individuals that this cares for, this has a problem with. But with regards to how we're moving on in the future, with regards to are we looking at any pilots or anything else, and delivery of elections, like many other public services, have been a real challenge under the pandemic. And I've been very open with colleagues and with stakeholder community that we haven't had made as much progress as we would have hoped to on this issue at this time. But as I've set out in my previous answer, progress has been made by the government and our partners in local government, and I am trying to drive this agenda forward in the coming months and years.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Training Officer, and certainly I do thank Mr. Briggs for posing this question. May the Minister reference the cross-party group visual impairment meeting last week, and I generally want to thank him for certainly his engagement with that, but also with the event that took place last October with the secret ballot box proposals that were put forward. But can the Minister actually, does the Minister actually share my belief that as a society, we must all do more to support blind and visually impaired voters, to actually allow them to vote in confidence and also in person, because they deserve to have that right to vote the way they actually want to vote in person.
Minister.
Well, you're going to hear this first, Presiding Officer, as me being a boy from Paisley and Mr McMillan being from Greenham. I strongly agree with the member. Improving the accessibility of elections with particular focus on people with sight loss is a programme for government commitment. I am in regular contact, as he knows, with the sight loss community on this vital agenda. And like the member, I found the event that we attended last year in the Forth Valley Sensory Centre valuable and instructive. And attending the cross-party group on visual impairment last week was another good opportunity for me to share everything and listen to the members of the community from their perspective. And can I say to all the members in here, when my commitment towards this, as when it comes to accessibility voting, they will understand that I have some reason to do this, with my wife also having a motability problem herself. So I will confirm that I will work as hard as I can to make sure we can make things better.
Question number 8, David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it anticipates any disruption to administration of forthcoming local government elections as a result of COVID-19 restrictions.
Minister.
Sorry, a minute there. Just got myself slightly mixed up here. Returning Officer. Returning officers are responsible for running elections. Preparations are taken account of guidance with the Electoral Management Board and the Electoral Commission, and will reflect the strategic framework. In running the local government elections, returning officers will draw on their previous experience in delivering last year's Scottish parliamentary elections safely and securely.
David Torrance.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Councillors from across all political parties work extremely long hours and are dedicated to helping their local communities, with many putting their careers on hold to do so. Yet the relative lack of financial protection for local councillors, being the only one of the only paid public roles, do not have financial protection or entitlement to redundancy, could pose difficulty in attracting people to take up the role of a local councillor. Does the Minister agree with me that this issue may need addressing to ensure that we can continue to attract people to participate in this vital aspect of our local democracy?
Minister.
As a former councillor myself, and aware of council colleagues who have difficulty when they end up in a situation where they are no longer a councillor, I recognise that councillors of all political affiliations work incredibly hard to improve the lives of people in their communities. The Minister for Social Security and Local Government
recently announced in partnership with COSLA an independent review of councillor remuneration will take place as a step towards supporting an increase in diversity of councillors in Scotland. I'll explore whether the issue raised by the member can be considered as part of this ongoing work.
Okay. And Neil Bibby, briefly, Mr Bibby.
Thanks, President Officer. Parliamentary candidates are entitled to one item of free post literature to each elector. Candidates in local government are not. Free posts would ensure that all candidates can get their message out to electors, even if public health restrictions return. So does the Minister agree with me that it's regrettable that this disparity has not been addressed in time for the council elections in May?
Minister.
Thank the member for that question. And this has been an ongoing debate, and it's actually one of the questions that was asked in, I think, two portfolio questions ago by Mr Briggs. Asked a similar question with regards to this. And this is a debate and an issue that we can talk about in the future, but it was one that at this stage was, when we started talking about it with COSLA and others, it was far too late for us for this election. I'm willing to talk to people, but we have to be very careful with the consequences that we should, when we get to that situation.
Thank you. That concludes that portfolio, and we move on to net zero energy and transport. And at question number one, I call Russell Finlay.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to reduce emissions produced by its ministerial cars.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
The Scottish Government is fully committed to the decarbonisation of its vehicle fleet, including vehicles used in the government car service. The GCS fleet is currently made up of 28 vehicles, of which 100% are ultra-low emissions vehicles. The Scottish Government has made the commitment to phase out the need for petrol and diesel cars for the wider public sector fleet by 2025. This includes the government car service, and to support this, a replacement strategy has been implemented to replace end-of-life vehicles with fully electric alternatives wherever possible.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Sitting in a stationary vehicle with the engine idling can result in a £20 fine, yet in most days ministerial limos can be seen doing just that in the Scottish Parliament car park. Even worse, they are frequently in disabled bays. Will the Minister commit to stopping these abuses?
Minister.
I thank the member for his supplementary question. Let me give him an assurance that I will raise this matter with the Government Car Service and get back to him in more detail. I understand the point that he's made. He will also recognise there is a need for a Government Car Service in all that we do in government. I take on board some of the points that he's made there. I'm not aware of government cars regularly waiting for long periods of time in the car park itself, but I'm happy to take these points up with the Government Car Service directly and get back to him.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Will ministers benefit from government cars? Hard-pressed commuters are facing the prospect of a new tax on going to work. Would the minister not agree that the best way to reduce emissions, whether it's from government cars or from commuters, is to back alternatives to car dependency, like buses under public control and a restoration of pre-pandemic rail services?
Minister.
I thank the member for a supplementary question. I assume he is referring to the workplace parking levy, and of course that would be a matter for Edinburgh City Council to arrive at a decision on, because this is a power for local authorities and then for employers to decide whether or not, including the Scottish Government, they pass that on to their employees. He makes a point regarding buses and public control. Of course, we have the Community Bus Fund in Scotland, which helps support local authorities, and there will be further powers coming to local authorities through the 2019 Transport Scotland Act. And with regard to public control of our railways, of course, I'm sure he will welcome that on the 1st of April, ScotRail will come into public ownership.
Question number two, Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how North Lanarkshire Council and other local authorities are supporting the rollout of free bus travel for under-22s.
Minister.
Like the long-standing older and disabled persons scheme, the new young persons free bus scheme went live on the 31st of January and is delivered through the National Entitlement Card. The Improvement Service is responsible for processing online applications, including through the online portal. Offline applications are handled by local authorities, and many councils have dedicated staff on hand to help applicants who might need particular support with the application process, including care experienced young people and asylum seekers. In some council areas, schools are coordinating applications on behalf of their pupils and will contact parents or guardians and pupils directly. North Lanarkshire Council, I know, are coordinating applications via schools for those pupils moving to secondary school.
Fulton MacGregor.
I thank the Minister for that response, and I hope, like me, she's looking forward to her visit to Coatbridge next week, where we'll give her a Coatbridge and Christen welcome. She'll be aware of the high levels of the... Oh, that's... She'll be aware of the high levels of deprivation and low income in my constituency and the North Lanarkshire area more generally, which mean that many children and young people may not have access to the internet, a passport, a driving licence, and so they need to apply for the entitlement to free bus travel offline. So does the Minister share my disappointment that it would seem that the Labour Tory administration in North Lanarkshire is not doing more to enable more of these young people to get their entitlement through council offices and facilities like libraries, particularly when they stand to benefit the most from being able to access the free bus travel scheme?
Minister.
I would share some of Mr McGregor's reservations there, although I have to say that local authorities are really key in the delivery of this scheme. I wrote to local authorities, I think, the week before the scheme launched to ensure that those mechanisms were put in place. But really, the collective efforts of the Scottish Government, the Improvement Service, local authorities and the National Entitlement Car Programme Office, Young Scot and bus operators is going to be crucial, those organisations working together to deliver this landmark policy. And I look forward, of course, to the welcome that I'm to receive next week. I recognise and I understand, though, that some people have found the online application process pretty complex and hard to undertake at times, not least because of the identification requirements. Now, I've met with the Improvement Service on this, who manage the online application process, to discuss those issues, and they are currently reviewing the application process to make it as straightforward as they can. But I think, given the importance of the offline application channels that Mr McGregor spoke to, particularly for the people he mentioned who might not have internet access or the required documentation, on the 31st of January, as I mentioned, I did write to all local authorities, and it's really important that they do put in place those measures to help support the offline application process. And in that letter, I really pointed out to local authorities the importance of this, but also, I think, of the school option, so using that school mechanism to better identify young people who don't have access to the internet and to ensure that they are signed up to benefit from the under 22 scheme.
Mark Crossgold.
Thanks. Can I, alongside those options, also welcome yesterday the launch of the Transport Scotland app, I think targeted at young Scot card holders to enable them to migrate their existing cards over to the new under 22's entitlement. Can the Minister say a little bit more about that and how many people that will benefit potentially?
Minister.
Mr Ruskell is correct to point out that on Monday we launched the Transport Scotland Pass Collect app. Now, it lets existing cardholders who are aged 16 to 21 download the free bus travel app onto their current card, and that will make it easier for up to 140,000 existing cardholders in this age group to start enjoying the benefits of free bus travel. But by close of business on the 1st of March, the Improvement Service reported that the National Entitlement Car Programme Office had dispatched 144,377 NECs or Young Scot NECs with free bus travel, and that includes over 100,000 applications which were submitted online and just over 40,000 which were produced via offline routes.
Question number 3, Alex Rowley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to increase bus usage across the country.
Minister.
The Scottish Government is investing over £500 million during this Parliament for bus priority infrastructure, and from April the Network Support Grant will provide an additional £40 million to support services as demand recovers from COVID. We are implementing the powers in the Transport Scotland Act 2019 to help local transport authorities improve services in their areas and introduce the Community Bus Fund to support them to do so. And to encourage children and young people to travel sustainably, we've also recently launched the free bus travel for under 22s in Scotland, and that complements our continued support for existing free bus travel for disabled people and for over 60s.
Alex Rowley.
Minister, for that answer, I've recently found myself in a position where I'm unable to drive and I've become much more dependent on public transport. From my home in Kelty to my regional office in Lochgelly, it took me about 10 minutes in the car. Now, to do it by bus, and bus is the only bit of public transport I can, it adds at least an hour to my journey. I have to get two buses, and for the return ticket, I would need a day ticket, and that costs £6.50. The comparison with public-owned Lothian buses is that I can get from one end of the city to the other end of the city for £1.80, and I can travel all day with a cap of £4.50. So how can the Scottish Government address the disparity that exists between different bus companies in different parts of the country? And what's stopping the Scottish Government from joining the trailblazers like Estonia and Luxembourg in expanding free public transport for everyone?
Minister.
I thank Mr. Riley for his question. So a couple of points to unpack there. I think there's a challenge here in terms of rural provision, first of all, and I do recognise the critical importance of bus services in rural areas in particular. And it would be difficult, for example, to compare his experience in Fife with those for people who live in Edinburgh, for example, where there are differing provisions. And I recognise some of the challenges there. However, with regard to his further point on powers for local authorities in this, we did consult on this in the Transport Scotland Act 2019. And we're working again with our local authority partners to help ensure that we can give them the opportunity to better serve their local area. The Community Bus Fund that I mentioned, I think, in response previously, is going to support local transport authorities to improve public transport in their areas. And also, it will include £1 million, which has been allocated to the Community Bus Fund. And we'll work with partners on the design of that fund. But to his wider point around about affordability, I've mentioned today some of our investment around about the Under 22 scheme. Additionally, I would point to the Fair Fares Review, which is being undertaken at this moment in time, and that will look at transport across all modes. And I think as well to his wider point about joining up journeys across different modes of transport and affordability, which I recognise is a really... we're in challenging times just now with regard to the cost of living, so I do understand that, and I hope very much that the Fair Fares Review will give us some answers to some of the points that Mr. Riley has raised today.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister please detail how Scotland's young people are benefiting from the free bus travel scheme?
Minister.
The extension of free bus travel to all under 22s will make public transport more affordable, helping to improve access to education, leisure and work while supporting the adoption of sustainable travel behaviours early in their lives. And affordability, as we've heard, is a key issue for many young people. So giving that initiative on bus, which has the widest network of public transport provision across the whole of Scotland, will help in delivering our commitment to a just transition.
Student who was alarmed to discover that the night buses in Edinburgh are not covered by that scheme. Given the challenges that young women are facing in the UK just now in relation to gender-based violence and the commitments from this government on that matter, will the Minister consider extending the scheme to night buses?
Minister.
I hope Mr. Rennie will understand I'm not going to give him an assurance on that point right now in the Chamber, but I will take it away because he may be aware that during a statement I gave to Parliament, I think in the last week of term before February recess, I launched our plans to consult on women's safety on public transport. I think that's a much broader issue than just looking at night buses, but I do think that probably falls into the same area that I'm keen that we explore further because I recognise there's a challenge here. So I can't give him a direct answer, apologies, on the provision of the car, but I can undertake that this will be looked at and considered through the consultation because I recognise some of the challenges here very much so in terms of women's safety.
Question number four, Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update or when it expects to complete the programme of duelling the remaining sections of the A9 between Perth and Inverness.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Determination of the optimal procurement approach for the delivery of the remaining sections of the A9 duelling programme is ongoing. This is a complex exercise which is considering a pipeline of work in a form that can be delivered by the industry, supports the economic recovery post-COVID and minimises disruption to users of this lifeline route. It is expected that the work in progress will complete in the coming weeks to inform decision-making on our procurement approach, at which time an update will be provided.
Myrtle Fraser.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? We were originally supposed to have this programme completed by 2025. I appreciate that COVID has got in the way, but I'm concerned we still do not have any definitive timescales for completion of this work, given the amount of interest there is in communities along the A9 on seeing what is one of Scotland's most dangerous roads completed. We also have an issue with owners of properties along the A9 route, whose properties are effectively blighted at present, because until definitive plans are published for the new route, they don't know whether their properties might require to be compulsory purchased or not. So the need for certainty around this issue is acute. Can the Cabinet Secretary be more definitive as to when Parliament will be told when the next deadlines will be set?
Cabinet Secretary.
And also, I recognise the point which the member is making, and he will acknowledge and recognise that, or he did acknowledge and recognise that COVID-19 has had an impact on the timetabling for the completion of the drilling of the A9. What the member will also be aware is that the design work for the remaining 8 sections is well advanced. Of those, the statutory process has commenced for 7 of those sections, and 4 of which already have completed made orders. So they are already at a very advanced stage in determining the route which the road will take. Once we have completed the procurement approach exercise, which has been undertaken at the present moment, that will help to inform the development of the finalised timeline for taking forward the remaining sections of the road. And at that point, we should be in a better position to inform what the final delivery timescale will be for the completion of the road.
Question number 5, Jamie Halcrow-Johnston.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made on the procurement of new ferries.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
The Scottish Government announced investment of £580 million in ports and vessels as part of our wider 5-year infrastructure investment plan in February of 2021. This investment is in addition to the delivery of MV Glensanex and Hull 801, which are under construction. Caledonian Maritime Assets Limited is currently assessing bids from 4 shipyards for 2 new major vessels on the Islay routes, and CMAL are also progressing design work for the small vessel replacement programme, considering up to 7 vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides route and for Gourock to Dunoon and Kilcreggan.
Jamie Halcrow-Johnston.
I thank the Minister for that answer. In February 2021, Michael Matheson admitted to me that the Scottish Government's purchase of the existing ferries operating on the Northern Isles routes had made the target of 30% of public ferries to be low emission by 2032 more stretching. So can the Minister tell us what the Scottish Government has done over the last year to make make achieving that target more realistic, and is she confident that target will still be met? And can she confirm to me, when they're completed, that the 2 long overdue vessels at Ferguson Marine will meet the latest standards for low emission technology?
Minister.
So on the first point Mr Halcrow-Johnston raises around about 801 and 802, both of those routes are really important. The latest update from the Yard's turnaround director indicated that the handover of 801 is now planned for summer 22 and 802 for summer 23. But following handover to CalMac, it's estimated that a further 3 months will be required for testing, training and familiarisation before the vessel is able to enter service. Now, he asked a very specific question with regard to emissions. I don't have a note of that in front of me, but I'm happy to write to the member and give him an update on that in due course.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree that the smaller vessel replacement programme, which is essential to enhance services to islands such as Cumbria in my constituency, should be expedited given the increasing number of breakdowns suffered by older, smaller vessels, the impact on lifeline services to some of our most fragile island communities?
Minister.
I thank Mr Gibson for that question. Yes, I do. I very much recognise some of the frustration in our island communities regarding resilience at this moment in time, which has not least been compounded by poor weather recently. And I know that it's hugely important for the communities in particular that he serves. I'm also pleased to reiterate that what I've just said, which is that good progress is being made on the small vessel replacement programme with design work well underway. And I know Mr Gibson and I are due to meet very soon. I'm sure we can discuss it in further detail at that time.
Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The state of lifeline ferry services in Scotland is unacceptable, and islanders have frankly lost faith in this government's handling of ferry procurement. Only last week, Cumbria Community Council told me that the latest technical faults meant children missed school, patients missed medical appointments, and businesses were unable to open. So what will the Minister do to upgrade the CalMac fleet to ensure their new fit-for-purpose ferries are serving islands such as Cumbria? Because islanders are fed up waiting, and can the Minister confirm that she's also willing to meet Cumbria Community Council to hear directly their concerns?
Minister.
I didn't catch the first part of Mr Bibby's question, but to the second part on Cumbria Community Council, yes, more than happy to do so. I met actually this morning with Angus Campbell, who chairs the Ferries Community Board, and we had a wide-ranging discussion on some of the points Mr Bibby has mentioned this afternoon, including, of course, the resilience of the fleet, looking at contingency plans, but equally on that community engagement, which is where I recognise some of the tensions play out. I will be meeting actually Mr Bibby tomorrow, I think, and I'm more than happy to meet with the Community Council.
Can I just ask Mr Bibby, would you like to put the first part of your question again?
No, it's okay, Presiding Officer. I'm satisfied with that response. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Question number 6, Joe Fitzpatrick.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its action to decarbonise buses.
Minister.
On Monday, I announced grant awards worth £62 million to support bus operations to acquire 276 new zero-emission buses and associated charging infrastructure. And this means the government has now supported the acquisition of 548 zero emissions buses, of which 344 have been or are being built in Scotland. These have been well split across the country and include investment in the bus fleet in Dundee, which I'm sure Mr Fitzpatrick will have noted in his own constituency. And the most recent funding has included support for several smaller and more rural operators, which is vital for a just transition to net zero and will be the priority for future funding.
Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. And yes, thanks to the substantial Scottish Government funding, a dozen brand new zero emissions electric Emerald buses have been deployed across Dundee by Explore on the number 28 route, which includes Lochie Road in my constituency, the fourth most polluted street in Scotland. Does the Minister agree that the SNP can be proud of the support provided to drive forward decarbonisation of buses in Dundee, delivering clean, green and free public transport for young people in my city?
Minister.
Absolutely. Dundee City Council are a great example of what can be achieved when the SNP is in charge, both at national and at local government level. The Scottish Government supported the dozen electric buses with £2 million award to Explore Dundee in 2021, and under the Bus Partnership Fund, we've awarded Tayside Bus Alliance with £586,000 to support appraisal work covering improvements to strategic bus corridors in the region. And on top of that, the Council is advancing a project to deploy 12 hydrogen buses for operation in Dundee, supported by the Scottish Government and Scotland's Hydrogen Accelerator as well, and the Michelin Scotland Innovation Park. And the park, of course, serves as a key hub supporting sustainable zero-emission mobility in Scotland, including the technology and skills needed to support a fair and just transition to net zero economy.
Liam Kerr.
172 buses supported by the forerunner Scottish Ultra Low Emission Bus Scheme. Nearly a quarter were imported from a Chinese manufacturer at a cost of over £11 million. Now, the Minister said earlier this week that fewer than half of the new buses supported by the Zero Emission Bus Challenge Fund will be built in Scotland. Can the Minister then say whether the rest of them will be built in the UK, or will those orders go abroad as well?
Minister.
I thank Mr Kerr for his question. First of all, I'd like to point out that 137 of the buses are being built in Falkirk. That means they're creating local skilled jobs. He asked me to give an assurance around about the future of this scheme. The scheme is now launched. The first part of ScotZEB launched on Monday. We will then evaluate the impact of that scheme and look to learn lessons from the future. But he's right, we should be investing in sustainable green jobs in Scotland, and I agree with him on that point.
Question number 7, Sue Webber.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it plans to provide to rural households to transition to net zero heating.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Rural households can face challenges in the transition to zero emissions heating, challenges such as generally higher costs of installation, often older buildings and fuel poverty. In recognition of this, our area-based schemes provide enhanced support to rural households, and the Warmer Home Scotland scheme supports those in or at risk of fuel poverty. We made £3 million available this year for Scotland's most remote off-grid communities to upgrade their energy systems. And as we develop the island's energy strategy, we're considering options for an island's uplift across our delivery programmes to provide additional support in island areas.
Sue Webber.
I thank the Minister for the answer. And can he now say how will the Scottish Government ensure that households in the rural and isolated areas will be able to keep their homes warm in the case of power cuts that last for multiple days, such as the storms Eunice 2 weeks ago and Storm Arwen last November?
Yep. Minister.
Thank you. I mean, the answers to this partly lie with Scottish Government programmes and partly with action that we need from the UK-regulated energy system to ensure that we have upgrades to the electricity grid to make them more resilient. This factor is one that is recognised in the Scottish Government's heat and building strategy and in our ongoing work and engagement with the UK Government. But it is worth recognising that even existing fossil fuel boilers will suffer if there's an electrical power failure. People cannot necessarily rely on existing systems and some of those challenges for the resilience of the electricity grid apply to existing systems just as they will to net zero heating systems.
Question number 8, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with rail unions regarding the nationalisation of ScotRail.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
Engagement with staff and trade unions began in early January, and I'm pleased to confirm that arrangements for the formal transfer of ScotRail staff to Abellio ScotRail Limited to ScotRail Trains Limited are progressing as planned. I personally met with the rail trade unions on the 10th of February and welcomed their open and frank discussions on several topics. I've also arranged to meet each trade union individually over the coming weeks, starting tomorrow.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer, and can I also thank her for meeting the unions and for her ongoing engagement. She will therefore be aware of their view, which I share, that freight by rail should be increased. The Rail Delivery Group believes there should be trebling of rail freight in England and Wales by 2050. That would mean a reduction of CO2 emissions of 4.2 million tonnes a year. Meeting that target would require a 4% annual increase and 22% in the next 5 years. But Transport Scotland's target is just 7.5% in that period. So does the Minister agree with me that Transport Scotland's target should be far more ambitious, and will she set out how she plans to increase freight by rail?
Minister.
I thank Mr Simpson for his question. I don't want to prejudge the outcome of the meetings that I'm about to undertake with the trade unions, which will cover a range of issues that were rehearsed in, I think, the debate we had before the end of term, but also in the parliamentary statement. He touched upon the issue regarding freight, and he's absolutely correct. We need to facilitate that modal change from the road onto our railways. I'm keen to support that work, but equally, I want to speak to the unions first and not to prejudge it. He's asked me to give him an update today in terms of the freight targets with Transport Scotland. I can't give him it right now, but if he will allow me to come back to him on the specifics of that point, I'd be more than happy to do so, because I do recognise the challenge here and I'm keen to support the work additionally.
Okay, I can take a question from John Mason, if the question and response are very brief. Mr Mason.
Thank you. Can the Minister confirm that considerable extra funding was provided by the Government to the railways for both COVID and nationalisation? And can she confirm if Labour and the Tories acknowledged this or supported it in the budget?
Minister.
Well, whilst it's disappointing they did not support the budget, I would reiterate that since 2007 this Government has made over £9 billion of investment into our railways, helping to reconnect communities, improving services and the rail infrastructure all over the country.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause before the next item of business.